I'm very grateful to have been given the opportunity to present you the project Reyklius DE. It's not about results. You will not see many results because it's still underway. It's still being worked on. There are not so many results. But it's just about giving you ideas for further reasoning, further thinking, in order to join in together into a discussion on what should actually be done within the scope of this project. It's not because we do not know what to do, but because one important aspect of this project is to try to place ready, to make available data that is actually usable for people using it, better than the output of regional climate models as known to, as of today. Reyklius DE contributes to simulation contributions to the Eurocodex project, which was briefly introduced by Mrs. Fischer-Bruns yesterday. This is a project sponsored by the BEDF, based on big river catchment areas, with both the dynamic models, as you can see here, regarding to simulation for the entire Eurocodex zone, which is Europe, basically, and then we have statistical models and dynamical models for models based on sufficient wealth of data, which means Germany and maybe border regions, cross-border regions. That means the river, the rivers flowing into Germany. Two scenarios are in the focus, RCP 2.6 and RCP 8.5. This is due to the initiative having been created by Mr. Wolf during the Annaberg climate days. He said normally an ICPP assessment should be done for Germany. We should make a nationwide, Germany-wide effort within the climate research community, and Mr. Becker from DWD and Mrs. Jacob from today's JARIX were asked, and they were eager to work together with, and this was the germ cell having created the Reyklius DE project. In order to give advice to politicians, it's very important to have limit scenarios, 2-degree scenarios, and the second scenario, meaning business as usual. We have selected five global climate models that we use for evaluation, and five regional climate models. Our resolution is the grid of 12.5 kilometers. And for the evaluation, this is the advantage when being attached to a huge project. We have a huge ensemble of data, more than the data runs we did on our own, far more. A particularity is that this project was not initiated by research, but by the German states. That means during the technical talks between the state level and the region, the federal state level and the regional state levels, regarding interpretation of regional climate model data and climate consequences and adaptation. Representatives of the state offices for the environment and of the political decision makers come together in order to see how to use and handle the results. We then said we need a database that allows us to initiate talks with a political level. Do we need to make new estimates, assessments? Are we still on the safe side? We wanted to be prepared for this, and that is why this project was initiated, headed by the Hessian State Office for the Nature, Environment and Geology, me personally, so to say. So not the work groups, so the advantages and disadvantages linked to that. Of course, we have an accompanying group, a project accompanying group, which is meant to integrate the scientific developments with the practical needs. I think you understand, it's quite theoretic, but I think you understand what I mean. So there's a huge focus on how to imply users, how to involve users. We have first test users allowed to test preliminary data, telling us whether it's better than before, what should be changed, and there will be an interim workshop which is going to take place in the month of June, where we wish to discuss with you. The general outlines, general objectives or topics are: how do the results from the new RCP scenarios match the results from the old SRES scenarios? We have a lot of findings from former periods with the SRES 1B scenario. And how is the correlation between the new and the old ones? And always the important question: are there systemic differences between the results from the statistical and the results from the dynamical models? Characteristics, systematic differences. One of the experts asked us to run test simulations with a high resolution of 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer in order to try and test whether hydrological events in the big rivers, that's very important, in the streams. It's like Elbe Oder. Whether the 12-kilometer grid is okay as a resolution for such a large-scale river catchment zone, or whether the only conclusive results can be obtained with high resolutions. That means also high computational needs. But we will not work into this because we don't have the money for it. It was not given to us. How much should an ensemble be to be stable and robust enough to withstand the addition or the removal of another model? So we are meant to use ensembles, but what is the minimum number we should have and use? Or maybe it's oversized. The final point is, how should we process the results in order to allow you as impact researchers to use them in a proper way? Normally it's done like this: data is provided and the user should take it or leave it. We think that's not the good approach. At least this project is meant to give us a tool to try to come up with joint development strategies for an improvement at that point. Here you see an information matrix. The top row shows the regional models used by us, and the left column shows the global models, and everything in between in dark blue is the Recklius simulation, and the light blue are used within the Eurocortex simulations. So we try to bring it all together in order to have a comparative matrix. You see, there was only one run with the MPESMLRE for the RCP 2.6. All other runs are for the RCP 8.5. So the 8.5 scenario was used as a kind of residence in order to have a comparative basis for matching the two models. On the one axis we have the global models, and on the other axis we see the difference between the two scenarios, because we cannot have an infinite number of model runs.
Jetzt zeige ich Ihnen, wie wir diese globalen Modelle ausgewählt haben.
This is how we selected the global models. Several criteria were used. But the main approach was we want to try to cover the largest possible bandwidth of the results and maintain them. Climate sensitivity, precipitation change and all of it. We didn't want to downscale it, but we wanted to have different.
Um das machen zu können, müssen die mindestens eine räumliche Auflösung von T63 haben.
So T63 should be the minimum spatial resolution. That's the resolution of 200 kilometers. Mesh width, I think.
Grid width.
Time series should be at least 1971 to 2100. And it actually is a tricky thing. Data consistency is difficult. Two models had to be dropped because the data available
als Antriebsdaten für alle unsere Modelle
could not be used as forcing data for our models. This list, please do not read or memorize this. I'm just showing you. We have a list. Whether, if you need the list and you wish to go into detail, then you can download it and it will be part of the presentation and to be published. But don't read it now.
So,
what you see here are the change signals regarding all global climate simulations carried out for the fifth assessment report of the IPCC. You have temperature along this axis, precipitation amount along the other axis for the period 2069 to 2098. Don't ask me why. So maybe it was not actually finished, finalized. I do not know. In comparison with the reference period regarding a region covering roughly Germany. What you see here is the change signal in winter time. You have the temperature range for winter signals, but it's not full scale. We have even higher warming signals, but which could not be used for various reasons. There were technical reasons, as already mentioned, but partly there were basic philosophic approaches, plausibility reasons. You see the precipitation change, left-hand axis. You see an increase in precipitation for this area, German area, for winter. In summer, the picture is a bit different. There we have quite a lot of models showing a reduction in precipitation, but also several models showing an increase in precipitation amounts. We wanted to have at least one model showing an increase in precipitation in order to have a representative range of models. And that is why we selected the models to be evaluated according to their place in the distribution, also in terms of the response to forcing in terms of greenhouse gases. These are the models we finally select in order to have a good coverage of the whole distribution area. Then we proceeded to the comparison between SRES and RCP scenarios. This is taken from the assessment report. Also the broken lines actually end in 2300. But they were designed for 2100. You see the radiative forcing in watt per square meter. This is the SRES A1B scenario, for which we produced the majority of results available. This is RCP 4.8.5 in red, 4.5 2.6. We have the positive forcings, negative forcings, especially due to sulfate aerosols. So the SRES scenarios show high radiative forcings due to the assumption of high levels of sulfate aerosols. Filter technologies have shown that we do not emit so many sulfate aerosols as originally planned, so that is why we have here a negative impact due to aerosols, but this aspect is outdated. Meanwhile. Attention, surprise, this is the result of the comparison, but we must see these are two generations of global climate models. These are not the same climate models behind. You see the temperature change, temperature difference in Kelvin over the years until 2100, and then we have a tube plot with a huge area, where the dotted line, the light dotted line, showing the scenario A1B. We have the broken line, in this area is the Eurocortex run for 8.5, and the solid line boundary shows 4.5, RCP 4.5. For the Reichtiers runs, with 2.6 is not yet included, the number of runs are not sufficient. At least they are not ready and not online yet. But that is what we would like to discuss with you, what we wish to provide to you as a decision-making aid for your work with the results provided. But now Mr. Hessel is very critical, he knows better.
Da liegt das A1B zum Teil über dem RCP 8.5.
A1B is partly on top of the RCP, and we know that for 8.5 the forcing is higher than in the SRES A1B. Just remember. What's the reason? Why is this different here? One reason is that the models were continued and further developed. So that the climate sensitivity, that means air temperature change on the basis of the assumed forcing, has less impact on the further developed models. But on the other hand, in A1B, we have 15 regional simulations, ensembles, and these are not the same models. So that means we have a broad range of outlier models. There are two models in the ensemble, global models, that have a very low climate sensitivity. There also was one outlier to the peak side. So it's not a 100% comparability. But when looking at the 8.5 results, less than the A1B, then that's what I explained. Further results here to come. It's not new to you, I think. You know that all model data have certain weak points or errors. So if you say the contrary, you are either a liar or a poor workman. So how do what do we do? How do we process the data and use the data, utilize the data in a way to allow you to use them better? I just say it like this, just thesis I'm supplying to you. Better back proposals. You actually know better what your needs are, but my ideas are. For example, what could we do? Should we use area averages across catchment areas, across natural regions? And would this help us in a better way than dithered data? Can we use mean values in a better way? Or statistics regarding extreme values? You work on extreme on time series. You have extreme events with a certain point of time and a certain peak and so on. Do forget this for future simulation. What we can offer you is statistics, maybe spatial, temporal, maybe in terms of frequencies of occurrences. Let's say you have 3 winter storms in 10 years, so it's actually a difference. Did they appear during 1 year and 9 years there was nothing, or were it 3 consecutive winters, or maybe every 3 years you have a huge winter storm? So this is a huge difference. I think these are types of information that we might obtain, extract from the climate models without day-to-day values, of course. That's the point of discussion. That's what I would like to discuss with you. Bias adjustment, that's another topic, but I'm not going into this because we would discuss without any end today. So instead, I'm going to present you the natural regions we have in Hesse. Everything starting with number 2, this is Rhine-Main lowlands, and maybe even in the Rheingau area, even if I don't have a grid, a representative grid, maybe I can use a grid box from a similar natural area. Or we have the Taunus Mountains. Is it possible to use to regard the Rhone and the Odenwald and the East Hessian uplands together? So this would help me to come to an evaluation in terms of a spatial resolution that's more useful to you than our grid measures. Just a question asked like this. It should not be new to you that daily values taken from the climate models and sub-daily values are hard to use and are very erroneous partly. What could we do instead? Maybe time aggregation in order to, on the basis of seasonal values. Let's say we have a mean increase in precipitation, but we can say we have a frequency of winters with above average or below average precipitation, followed by spring with the same lack or excess of precipitation. This information might be more useful for you than the daily values. I cannot tell you whether we will actually succeed in this and whether it's possible to supply this, but what are the needs? What should we try to do in order to make work easier for you? So the frequency of occurrences of events, I explained with the winter storms, that's something I understand very well, and it's my favorite examples. The next point, synthetic time series. Here you see the result of 10 various models, RCP 8.5, 10 various models, change in precipitation according to the various models over the entire century, by seasons, seasonal. You see interesting things, interesting values. So when looking at this, take any curve, then you see at a glance that you actually did not cover the entire bandwidth. You can use more, but then of course it would be huge fun in order to screen that to detail. But I'm telling you what I mean by synthetic time series. Let's say we set up a time series where all positive
Und wir nehmen gar nicht
Summer Extremes
was weiß ich, die blaue Linie
are included.
Oder sowas,
ja? Not just one model,
but we collect
all maximums.
Ja? Das ist dann natürlich keine physikalisch konsistente Zeitreihe mehr.
Of course, it's not a physically consistent time series, but it's a kind of stress test for your impact system. It's a worst case scenario. All extremes put together. Maybe it's useless, it's not meaningful, maybe it doesn't make sense for you, but maybe you say, okay, yeah, that's a worst case stress test. What is, does my impact system actually cope with such an extreme case? And you can do the same for the minimum extremes. Could you collect all that? Do you use an actual curve? Just an idea like this. Yeah, please.
Was ich möchte,
tear off my idea, but just. I'd like to enter into discussion. I'd like to start today and then during the next workshop. The flyers are outside in order to invite you to come there. It's a workshop in Potsdam on the 14th and 15th of June in 2016, and we would like to see users come and discuss with us. But it's actually, I'd like to warn you, it's a workshop, so it's, you should come for working. And it's not just about presentations held one after the other. But of course, we will present the, we present our work. But with posters, but you will have to discuss with us. It's a joint discussion event, and afterwards you are meant to go into, after the first presentation, you are asked to go into work groups, into where you have two modelers open to discussion. They then want to discuss with you what can we do to serve you better. I want to go beyond the exchange of statements, exchange of views. One side says we need this, and the other side says, but we can do only this. I wish the two parties, the two sides, to actually go together, to get closer to one another, to listen, to bring together the wealth of knowledge, of information, of data we already have on the basis of the climate models. A lot of, we have a lot of knowledge. We know about the uncertainties. There's a lot we do not know. But how can we actually prepare it for better use, better practical use by you? So this is the end of my presentation. Here I show you our partners contributing to the project, our project partners, and you are invited to come to our workshop. Many thanks for your attention.
Ja, vielen Dank, Frau Müller, für den
Many thanks, Mrs. Müller, for your very committed lecture and presentation and for your invitation in order to bring together the producers of data and the users of data. It's a very important point in many models. It's, many promises were made and were actually not kept. In the end, I think you have made a bit of progress. Yeah, we should try to make progress, to go forward. And the Annaberg Climate Days are the forum par excellence. That's the forum where my commitment is the good, the right place. It's about hope, hopefully.
Bitte.
I have several questions, but I'd like to start off with one. We could do it outside. The selection of the general coupled circulation models that you made, the models that you selected, had no relation to the quality of the models, whether they actually reflected the climate trends properly. There were studies from our US-American colleagues showing us which, what is crap and what is high quality. I did not show that, but we actually did this. Various aspects and criteria were used. We basically opted for the models which, according to our experience, are a good representation of the climate trends. We had a look at the usual candidates, but we also said that we wanted to have one or two non-usual models, extra European models covering another area, territory, and also the bias discussion, which you mentioned. We should make this discussion. We should, just to explain our reasoning, our rationale of selection, our strategy for the selection. So it was part of it. May I ask the second question? Yes. There are already modelers of the next level, CINIP6. And there will be no further scenarios. The group actually agreed on getting away from scenarios related to IPCC in any way. And every group could say on its own what it actually would offer, and at least we will have a huge number of widely diverging models, but covering a broader range. Now, let's say you work for further 2 years, then in the end it will be old and outdated and old-fashioned. So the question is, how far can you lag behind in terms of impact research with regard to the latest model results? This topic will be very crucial in 2 years. I'm sure. Bjorn Stevens told me, who works in our institute, highly committed with CINIP6 activities, and one of the leading actors there, leading players, that will be a kind of revolution in contrast with scenarios. And for many years I've been telling him that that the scenario that you used rather often is a horror scenario that normally cannot come into practice and happen. 8.5, you have such a lot. Why did you use such a high number of 8.5? I can give you the answer. First of all, scientifically, of course, the RCP scenarios have now come, or the political world has become aware of the RCP scenarios. So they lag behind in terms of scientific progress. And a huge question is also to freeze models, because impact research actually wants to have frozen models, stable models, fixed models, and coming up with new things all along the way is tricky. We see our responsibility as advisors of the political world to supply interpretation aids, not just model results, but interpretation aids. How can we actually use the results? How can we prepare old results for new challenges, and how do we make the correlation between all the new results? This is part of our project, our responsibility, and the reason why we use 8.5 so often is that this scenario is the scenario based on our emission scenario, Mario, not since 2013. Very precisely, I can tell you that on behalf of our president, he says that's the path on which we progress, that's as in the past, and when speaking with the politicians, how much money is to be invested into climate mitigation measures, then we must have the whole range between the worst case scenario, we wish to avoid the worst case, but the worst case and best case scenarios are two extremes which we would like to avoid.
Das hatten Sie ja auch in Ihrem Vortrag gesagt,
in your paper as well, you spoke about the probability of keeping this promise. So, but we have to range between the worst case, best case scenarios in the political world for the decision making, and that is why we opted for the scenario, because it is our emission path. And scenarios have the advantage to make things comparable. You already said, in the end, you will have a kind of zoo of models of diverging aspects. Then you need a correlation for obtaining information. So the forcing's intensity or breakdown of the forcings on the one hand, and the model units and the climate sensitivity, cloud parameterization causing diverging precipitation patterns. So this model intercomparison project and their systemization approaches had the advantage that you were able to differentiate what comes from forcing, what is the result of the model structure itself. Yeah, and for the models we can say, yeah, we do not know, but what we see in terms of forcing, that's what we can actually have an influence on. So this is but we, of course, we can discuss a long time.
Weitere Fragen.
Further questions.
Hannes Franke.
Hannes Franke.
Ich habe keine Frage, sondern
I do not have any question, but I'd like to comment on the workshop.
Wo ist das, der ist, es ist ja schon ein halbes Jahr oder dreiviertel Jahr bekannt, dass es den geben wird.
It's already known that it was announced half a year ago. I think it's well designed.
Ich bin auch schon angemeldet, und zwar
I already filed my application in September last year.
Im Fachbereich, also im Geschäftsbereich,
in our division of the Ministry of Environment and Agriculture, we had a similar workshop and asked all the impact researchers and impact people.
Yeah,
we then asked them, what is your experience? What's so we actually tried to, and we have the results of that, and so I will bring along the results of our internal workshop. I hope that there are more people like you coming with their experience, also giving good experience. It's not all, because it's not important to invent the wheel several times. Another remark, we are very grateful that this workshop was designed and is announced and will be held, and it's not just about tapping shoulders, because of course it's not a matter of course. It's very important to come to a good joint basis. So I liked it very much, and that's what I wanted to say. The flyers are presented on the table outdoor, in front of the door, in the lobby, and there